This is 10's late news with all the news you need this Tuesday tonight. Unsubscribe the government to release a new plan to make it easier to get out of unwanted memberships and crack down on dodgy price practices. The search for answers, an inquiry into the nerve agent death of an innocent woman, hears shock claims about Vladimir Putin's involvement. Israel's promise to the US as it finalises its planned attack on Iran. The huge surety stumped up by the father of the man accused of running over a Melbourne model. The former Liberal leader accused of supplying drugs walks from politics. Above average rainfall and hotter temperatures, so is Australia headed for another La Niña? Violence and murder, Canada's explosive allegations against high-ranking Indian diplomats. Why North Korea has blown up this road to its southern adversary. New tonight, fans turn up to cheer Ned Brockman as he nears the end of his second epic run. And remembering the one man that made the Iron Lady turn.
Why do people stop us in the street almost and tell us that Margaret Thatcher isn't just inflexible, she's not just single-minded, on occasion she's plain pig-headed.
Veteran journalist George Negus dies aged 82.
Welcome to 10's Late News with Ursula Hayes.
In developing news tonight, the federal government will tomorrow announce a crackdown on subscription traps, dodgy pricing and hidden fees that have left so many Aussies frustrated and out of pocket. Joining me now with the details is Network political editor Ashley Raper. And Ash, what is the government going to do?
Ursula, the Albanese government is planning to legislate to stamp out unfair and dodgy practices and has its sights on subscription traps. When it's really hard or confusing to get out of something you've signed up to, that can be anything from streaming services to gym memberships. It also wants to crack down on dynamic pricing, and we've seen a bit of that lately with concert ticket sales for Green Day and Oasis. It's where the cost of a ticket fluctuates depending on demand, so you could pay an inflated price because there happens to be a lot of people logged on to Ticketmaster or Ticket Tech wanting tickets at that particular time. But it also applies to other businesses. Surge pricing for Uber is dynamic pricing. Another practice the government has an issue with is drip pricing, hidden fees. So say you're buying a plane ticket, then all of a sudden there are add-on costs by the time you get to the payment part. This, though, is still something the government plans to do. It's not a concrete proposal, and Labor doesn't expect to have all the details worked out until some point next year. So, yet again, we're seeing an announcement from this government that's not fully formed. It's more trying to capture the attention of voters to be seen to be doing something to help with the cost of living crisis. Ursula.
Thank you. Ashley Raper there. Vladimir Putin personally authorised nerve agent to be used against a turned Russian spy and his daughter on British soil. That's the claim made in a new inquiry into the poisonings which led to the death of an innocent British woman. It unfolded on March 4, 2018. Former Russian spy and British double agent Sergei Skripal and his daughter Yulia were found unconscious in a park in the English city of Salisbury. They and the police officer who found them spent weeks in hospital, where it was discovered they were poisoned with the military-grade nerve agent Novichok. On March 12, then Prime Minister Theresa May said it was highly likely Russia was responsible. More than 2 months later, two civilians, Dawn Sturgis and Charlie Rowley, became seriously ill after being exposed to Novichok in a perfume bottle. Sturgis later died. In September that year, British police announced they had charged two men with attempted murder who they alleged were actually agents of the GRU, formerly the KGB. By this point, the men had returned to Russia, where they gave a bizarre interview proclaiming their innocence and saying they visited Salisbury to see the cathedral. Downing Street didn't buy this, and 6 years later, a government inquiry has revealed the death toll could have been much higher.
The evidence will suggest that this bottle, which we shall hear contained enough poison to kill thousands of people,
The inquiry will run until December and will examine the poisonings, the police response and the role of the Russian state in the attacks. Israel has assured the US its planned attacks on Iran will not target nuclear sites or oil facilities, according to new reporting from the Washington Post. Israel promised retaliation for a series of aerial attacks by Iran earlier this month, some of which penetrated the Iron Dome defence system. In a statement, Benjamin Netanyahu said while he will ultimately act in Israel's national interest, he intends to listen to America's opinion. Israel is relying on the US government for more air defence missiles, as new reports suggest they are facing a shortage. The driver accused of hitting and killing Melbourne model Elise Hodder has been granted bail after spending two nights in jail. Connor Matheson was allegedly drunk and under the influence of cannabis when he crashed in a Melbourne car park on Sunday as police arrived to break up an illegal rave. Elise Hodder died when she became trapped under the car.
Of course, he's relieved having been released on bail. I remind the community of the presumption of innocence and that bail is not concerned with punishing an accused man in advance of a criminal trial.
Matheson's father stumped up $100,000 in surety for his release and promised to supervise his son. Former South Australian Liberal leader David Spears has officially resigned from Parliament almost 3 weeks after being filmed ingesting an unidentified substance before being charged with drug offences. Alan Murrell has more.
In the end, David Spears' parliamentary career came to an end, not with a bang, but a simple email. He tendered his resignation as a state MP, which reached the Speaker at lunchtime. Mr Spears has not attended Parliament since quitting as Liberal leader 2 months ago. Since then, video purportedly showing him snorting a substance has emerged. His house has been searched by police and he's been charged with two counts of supplying a controlled substance. He flagged his intention to leave Parliament when he made those charges public a week ago.
That allows the people of Black to finally get an MP focused on them rather than worrying about deepfakes or allegations of deepfakes.
But these things are always challenging. It's been a really challenging time, but I think what the people of Black want is a hard-working, committed representative.
The earliest possible date for a by-election in his former seat is November 16. That will be the day after he's first due to face court on drugs charges.
A Sydney University worker is recovering from burns tonight after a chemical reaction triggered an explosion in inner city Sydney this morning. He and two others were exposed to the fumes. They were taken to hospital as a precaution. Firefighters have now safely contained the acids.
A reaction with two chemicals coming together, becoming unstable and flashing, a really minor type popping or an explosion causing a exothermic reaction with release of heat, significant release of heat and a vapour cloud.
Safe Work New South Wales is now investigating. 25-year-old Ned Brockman is tonight running the final laps of his latest gruelling physical feat in Sydney. The former tradie turned ultra-marathon runner has been spurred on by a revved-up crowd as funds to support the homeless keep pouring in. Sarah Naven was there.
The crowds rolled into Sydney Olympic Park Athletic Centre at 7 p.m. to cheer on Ned Brockman as he inches closer to his 1,600-kilometre target. He's expected to complete the target in the morning, so the public was invited in tonight to help cheer him on and give him the energy to finish the mission.
Just pretty monumental, I guess, and once-in-a-lifetime sort of thing, once-in-a-lifetime sort of bloke, so it'd be rude not to come down.
This guy's mental. I don't know how he's doing it, but I'm proud of him.
It's like he's not even human.
He has so far raised another $1.8 million for the charity Mobilise, all the funds going to support those experiencing homelessness. It's the second time he's captured the attention of the nation after running from Perth to Bondi for charity in 2022.
I don't know where it comes from. Mate, if we could bottle it, we'd sell it, wouldn't we? Make a fortune.
He's had a few high-profile sports champions run alongside him, including three-time Olympic gold medalist Jess Fox and UFC middleweight champion Israel Adesanya overnight.
I mean, I've been following Ned since I saw what he did running across the country, and I think he's inspired so many people.
So much respect for him, so much perspective has been gained today.
Ned's body has been pushed to the limit. He's had strings tying his feet to his shins as his feet are unable to lift themselves up anymore.
He's certainly feeling it. I think often when we talk about this stuff, it'd be easier to mention the things that aren't hurting right now. Everything's pretty sore. Knees, feet, shins.
We are told ice cream from the tub is helping him through, but certainly the cheering here tonight is making a difference to help him power through what will be 38 consecutive marathons.
What a good guy. Well, stay with us. Up next, how the PM is defending his multi-million dollar house purchase and why the amount you need to retire in your super isn't as much as you think. The PM has defended the purchase of a new multi-million dollar waterfront property, saying he knows what it's like to struggle. Anthony Albanese and his partner Jodie Hayden have snapped up a $4 million clifftop house on the New South Wales Central Coast. The purchase made public just as the PM announced 1,000 new homes in Queensland to help address the country's housing crisis.
Much better off as a Prime Minister. I earn a good income. I understand that I've been fortunate.
The PM is still to settle on the new home and says he has no plans to move into the property just yet. Australians fear they need significantly more money to retire comfortably than they actually do. An investment firm has revealed pre-retirees are aiming for more than $850,000, but the peak body says it's an overreach.
How much do you need in superannuation to comfortably retire? It's a question that keeps many up at night.
Between 1.5 and 2 million.
No clue.
Investment firm Generation Life polled pre-retirees, who responded with an average of $856,000 for a couple, when in reality, the Association of Superannuation Funds says $595,000 is enough for singles to draw an annual income of $52,000 and $690,000 for a couple to live off $73,000 a year.
People still feel way off in terms of what their retirement goals are, or the lifestyle that they want to have.
The current average balance for those entering retirement is about $450,000. Swimming legend turned CEO Grant Hackett says 4 out of 5 Australians feel they don't have enough savings to supplement the shortfall and think they need more. A finding echoed by advocacy groups.
If someone can actually retire debt-free, they are in a much stronger position.
They support the peak body findings and believe you don't need more than recommended to live comfortably.
And people can live very well of modest means. And it doesn't necessarily mean to have, you know, the flashiest of cars and the fanciest of houses and travelling all the time.
Jade Kotick for 10 News First.
Canada and India are locked in an escalating tit-for-tat diplomatic stoush over claims agents of the Indian government have been involved in murder and violence on Canadian soil. Canada today announced it was expelling 6 diplomats, including the High Commissioner, on the back of ample, clear and concrete evidence Indian agents were persons of interest in the death of Sikh separatist Hardeep Singh Nijjar. Nijjar, who was fatally shot in his pickup truck in June of 2023 in British Columbia, had been a leader in the movement to create an independent Sikh homeland in India's Punjab region. India has denied the allegations and expelled their own, but the Canadian PM is not backing down.
It is obvious that the government of India made a fundamental error in thinking that they could engage in supporting criminal activity against Canadians here on Canadian soil, whether it be murders or extortion or other violent acts.
Canadian police say they also have evidence of Indian diplomats collecting information on Canadian citizens that was then given to criminal groups to undertake acts of violence and extortion. In the heart of the ancient city of Petra, archaeologists have discovered a secret tomb containing 12 human skeletons and artefacts over 2,000 years old. Among the treasures was a cup strikingly similar to the Holy Grail, proving that sometimes history really does imitate art. The excavations were filmed for Discovery's Expedition Unknown show, with hundreds more artefacts expected to be uncovered. A NASA rocket has blasted off to an area of outer space no spacecraft has previously ventured to, the mysterious icy moons of Jupiter. The spacecraft successfully launched today, beginning its 2.8 billion kilometre journey to Europa, one of Jupiter's 95 moons. The bold mission will determine whether Europa's hidden ocean might be able to sustain life. The rocket won't be looking for life, but instead it will look for the ingredients necessary to maintain life, most notably in the ocean scientists believe exist beneath Europa's icy crust. This mission will take 5 years. Well, up next this Tuesday, the stunning sight that has lit up the night sky. Welcome back. Video footage released by South Korea's military shows the moment North Korea blew up two major roads and railways that connect both countries. Heavy machinery, including trucks and excavators, were later deployed to one of the roads. It marks an escalation of hostility after North Korea warned it would take steps to completely cut off its territory from the south. There's been shocking scenes in the US with two bystanders injured in this frightening crash. The accident happened during an air show in California when a Navy parachutist missed the landing zone. A mother and her daughter were taken to hospital for minor injuries. Another parachutist had landed safely earlier. The Navy says it will investigate. It was a police officer's lifelong mission to avenge her father's murder, and now, 25 years later, she has finally caught his killer. Ghislaine was just 9 years old when her father was shot dead by Raimundo Gomez in Boa Vista, Brazil. Despite multiple arrest warrants, Gomez managed to remain on the run. Years later, determined to bring him justice, Ghislaine became a police officer, gathering information about her father's killer before eventually hunting him down. She came face to face with him at the police station after his arrest, delivering the following chilling words.
It's because of me that you are here. You are now going to pay.
Gomez is now serving 12 years behind bars for the murder. Well, if you're not a fan of the rain, we have some mixed news for you. As Josh Holt explains, the chances of La Niña have dropped, but it's more complicated when it comes to downpours.
Good evening. Well, the Bureau of Meteorology met today to discuss the climate situation facing Australia over the coming months. Let's have a look at the situation here in terms of the ENSO. We're still at La Niña watch, but the chance of a La Niña unfolding over the next few months has dramatically decreased. We've still got significant cooling over the subtropical Pacific Ocean, as you can see here. That's North America to its north. And this is one of the areas that we look at in terms of figuring out if we're heading back towards a La Niña, El Niño or neutral conditions, but it's only one of the factors. We do have warmer than average global sea surface temperatures, in fact, at record levels at the moment. So even though the ENSO is pointing towards probably a neutral scenario through the back end of this year, we're still expecting above average rain from the east to the west coast. So why is that? Well, when you've got those record-breaking sea surface temperatures globally, there is more moisture in the atmosphere for rain systems to tap into and produce more rainfall in short periods of time. So we are expecting a wet and hot end of spring and beginning of summer across Australia at this stage, just to give you a bit of a heads up there. Shower or two for Brisbane tomorrow in 26 degrees, partly cloudy for Sydney in 21. Could see a shower in Melbourne. It should be dry in Adelaide with 28 degrees on Wednesday. Shower or two for Perth and 21, 39 degrees for Alice Springs. And at this stage, a shower or two for Darwin. Nothing huge into the rain gauges and a top of 34.
Thanks, Josh. Well, what you're about to see is the moment a rare meteor lit up the skies of Brazil. The space rock just reached our atmosphere but didn't come close enough to burst into flames. The meteor travelled over 270 kilometres before returning to space and going on its merry way. Well, and finally tonight, we want to pay tribute to a former colleague and a friend of ours here at Network 10. Veteran journalist George Negus has died at 82 following a battle with Alzheimer's. The former host of 6:30 with George Negus, the inaugural host of Foreign Correspondent and a founding reporter at 60 Minutes, was beloved by all who knew him and worked with him. In a statement, his family said George will be celebrated for his unique contribution to journalism, football and the environment. He would also want to be remembered for the incredible family man he was. The Prime Minister called Negus a giant of journalism who made even the smallest TV screen feel that much bigger. And we leave you tonight with some of his finest work, Vale George.
The whole idea of human rights in El Salvador today is a joke.
There's the all-important passport.
In the middle of nowhere, they're training to be guerrilla fighters to take on the Moroccan.
I didn't get a buzz. The disaster in Toowoomba unfolded when an intense band of rain hit about 1 p.m. local time.
Why do people stop us in the street almost and tell us that Margaret Thatcher isn't just inflexible, she's not just single-minded, on occasion she's plain pig-headed.
Still plenty of work to be done. All the best.